thrilled to be the only man. I expect special treatment.
Of course.
Oh, I forgot my phone.
Everybody will get special treatment. That's what this project's all about. Okay, so good. So you're in the right place. If you've selected use positive communication to increase community well-being. Nobody's leaving? Great. So I want to start with a bit of a brainstorm. So it'll be a bit of a group project. So partner with one or two people. And I just want to gauge, because I know some communities are doing it very, very well, and some would like to do it better. So if you can just get in groups of two, I guess, or three, how well is your community using positive behaviors? And so if you're not sure what that is, I would say take a guess at what that might mean for you to deliberately increase community well-being. Okay, so I'm going to give you 2 or 3 minutes to get into groups of two ideally, but groups of three is fine as well. As well. Thank you.
Hi, Tisha and Catherine, how about we pair up?
I think she's in the wrong
room. I'm sorry.
I thought she might
end. Okay, so. We'll get to that. We're all shocked.
I figured.
So, and what do you guys do?
I have the name Emily Pringley.
That's me.
That's so many years.
Just so many years. Not sure it is, but.
Where are you at now?
I work for Cancer.
What we do?
You looking for a lifeline?
Yes.
And I work for Dick Martin.
So I work for the Commissioner of Fitzgerald.
So I mentioned it for New York City.
Well, I don't know. I guess direct method that something that is so works best
for them.
So like, we need to allow us and have them.
Our Facebook is a home real world.
Yeah.
This is going into like senior.
All right.
I like pulling things together, so a lot of nuance, like when we throw something in here, like confetti.
Everybody ready to share?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right, so we're gonna look at what you currently have that you feel is working well to increase community well-being, and what you would ideally like to see. Go ahead. Anybody wanna?
I'll start.
You don't have to share, yeah.
The element is, I was saying that, you know, if I avoid sending an email and actually going to see the person in their office or something like that, you know, in the college itself. So it's fostering that face-to-face communication whenever possible versus written.
Right.
And so even if it's short or lengthy,
yes,
you know, being able to do that immediately with somebody. And I've realized that it's not only does it get things done faster sometimes, but also it's an opportunity to pop in and just ask, how are they doing? And figuring out, you know, and you can read them better, you know, in a sense you realize they're preoccupied or tired,
right,
or whatever, and you can like start with that,
mm-hmm,
and then give your message.
Right.
You know?
So I'm going to use the word you used yesterday. Creates connections.
Absolutely.
There you go. Good. Anybody else want to share? Yeah.
So one of the things that we do, I work at Learn, and I support the provincial resource team, and we support the Community Learning Center's initiative.
Okay.
And one of my roles is to help radiate the stories from the different CLCs through the Learn platforms, and so it's getting people to talk in a very passionate way about what it is that they're doing. And
right.
Ideally, I'd like to help increase their capacity to start writing those stories themselves in
nice.
A way that's a little bit more media ready.
Got it. Okay. So it's about celebrating.
Yeah.
And so they're doing that now through, with your help, and you're hoping that people be more autonomous.
Yeah, some of them are autonomous and they're doing wonderful things, but how do we get the network as a whole to kind of
promote it?
To promote it.
Yeah,
I was
going
to use more like pump out those stories.
Yeah.
Newsroom speak.
Yeah. You know, the sad part about that is that people get busy, right?
People
it's like,
get
yay,
busy.
We
yes.
did it. On to the next thing. So it's about pausing and reflecting. I like it. Anybody else?
Well, I'm the communications person, and one of the things that we do is every Tuesday we have a positive Tuesday
okay.
message.
Good.
So on our Facebook page we put out a positive
right.
news story.
All right. Good.
Sorry, communications person for?
Oh, for Vision Gaspic.
Oh, okay.
The organization, but I don't know everybody.
Vision Gaspic person.
So the two that you shared are more about, I think, the environment, right? So providing positive messages
mm-hmm.
for the environment to, you know, thrive. And yours was more of a personal one-on-one interaction. So we're gonna focus mostly on the personal one-on-one interaction. That's what this one's about. So let's look at the objectives. So this is a true workshop, because that's what I was signing up for, a workshop, so there's gonna be some work involved. I hope you're ready for that. By the end of the session, you'll be able to describe positive communication principles or behaviors. You're gonna do a little bit of a self-assessment using the models that I'm gonna share with you. We're gonna look at what are your personal benefits for possibly adopting some of these models. And then we're going to do a planning exercise. So there's going to be a little bit of activities throughout, but then we're going to end it with a planning exercise for you to answer the question, so what? Right? How can you make the best use of these 2 hours in the future? Does that sound okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Awesome. So I'm going to start with my own story. So I prepared this presentation for a world conference that I presented at in June, and it's called the Festival for IPEN, International Positive Education Festival and World Accelerator, very long name, but it was really wonderful to have global audience of people who use positive education, so we've talked a little bit more about what that is, and positive communication was my topic. So this is Being new to this school, I found my way to the classroom and I felt a seriousness come over me. I didn't know why. I stood at the door watching 75 serious faces, some looking out the window, some looking down, some looking at the principal who was speaking to them, and they were trying to listen very carefully. The classroom felt sad and empty, actually. The emotion was very heavy, yet the room was filled to capacity because it's usually a room for 25, and there were 75 in there. As I stood by the door, I felt their collective sadness. I turned to a teacher who was next to me, and she was also witnessing the scene, and I asked her, what happened? She explained. During recess, three students were not following the rules. As adults, we use our inner voice to guide our thoughts, words, and actions. In this moment, the unsafe behavior of three and past learned behaviors of the adult guided words and actions to reprimand all 75 sixth graders for the actions of three students. One by one, their light was going out. Now we have 72 demotivated students who were following the rules, three students who are clueless as to how their behavior has resulted in this, frustrated teachers, administrators, and no change in behavior. One of the students, Samantha, is bright, conscientious, and follows the rules all the time. As I learned later, she went home and cried, feeling like her exceptional behavior goes unnoticed. What can we do as teachers, parents, and administrators to keep their lights shining bright? To hold their light in our hands and to cultivate deep connection, respect, and inspiration. Outcome. What if we all, we commended all the students on their excellent behavior during recess, with specific examples, and then spoke with the three students individually to help them self-assess their behavior and identify areas of improvement and specific follow-up. A very different result would occur. So, that is my story that inspired me, actually, to present at the World Conference, but also to speak with you today. So my goal is really to take you through the process that I have worked through since 2014 to come to the models that I'm using today in practice with teachers and schools, as well as in organizations. So I have a couple of statements for you, and there's no right or wrong answer. I'm just curious to hear what your thoughts are. So, do you feel that positive communication can cultivate positive behaviors?
Yes.
So in theory, it sounds like it could be a true statement, right? But we're not sure. We're not sure because, you know, there's not a lot of research around this. I'm going to come full circle to the research at the end of my talk. So we're not going to select true or false because in principle it sounds like it might, but there's not a lot of research out there. Positive communication can help people feel closer to each other. True or false?
True.
True. Again, right? It sounds like it's probably going to yield positive results, but we're not sure. Positive communication can have our communities thrive. Probably that's why you're all here, right? And finally, what can it do for us personally? For our own well-being, right? And our own worlds. So I obviously am biased, so I'm going to just put it out there right now, obviously, that I believe all these are true. And my goal is to actually prove this with research. So one of my students, it was at McGill University, actually, and I was delivering a course, not on positive communication, but I used a lot of positive communication and positive education principles. And this is what he said. I highlighted the keywords in white, but you can certainly review the whole message. So I get a lot of these types of messages, and that, yeah, they learned a lot about the subject, but my goal is always to have people answer the question, so what? Who cares about what I just learned? You know, whether it's, I teach in the Department of Education here at Concordia as well, so I teach various different subjects, and I always use positive communication as part of my methodology. And so that's my goal, really, is to help the well-being of the student, to help them better integrate the learnings, but to really to make a connection, and to have the students make a connection with each other. And I love this quote, so awareness is like the sun. When it shines on things, they are transformed. That's the way I like to see it. So what exactly is positive communication? And more importantly, how do you recognize it? So there is some research. I'm going to share with you a few models. But before we go there, I'm going to ask you to find somebody new in the room that you haven't spoken with and talk about that. So how can you recognize positive communication when somebody else is doing it, or whether you're when you're doing it? How do you know, how can you label it as positive communication? I'm looking more so for behaviors. All right, so you can stand up, walk around, find somebody new. 2, 4, 6, 8, so we're an even number.
Ooh.
Ooh.
So we'll have one group of three. Get into groups and talk about how can you recognize positive communication. So I'm going to give you 2 minutes. 2 minutes.
Yeah, well, that's a culture layer which we're not addressing so much of. Well, so the key there is really not to assume, right? To make an assumption,
facial expression, it's just words.
That's a positive
positive, and the things we have to say, I think we're all in positions where we have to deal with unpleasant
how it makes you feel. So you can be having an unpleasant conversation about an unpleasant topic.
Yes.
But you don't feel like the world is coming down around you.
Right.
Rather, you feel like, okay, you know, we can do something.
So it's like an optimism or a feeling of can-do attitude, that
yeah.
sort of thing.
Okay, nice. Anybody else want to share?
Yes.
Well, we talked about how sometimes in communication between groups, there's often one group that is at the center and has a membership.
Uh-huh.
And that in organizations like that, messages get passed from the center out.
Yes.
And sometimes how the messages are framed can be taken by members as orders or suggestions. So it's how you phrase things.
Okay, yes, so the language.
Yeah,
phraseology. We're going to do an activity around phraseology later. Anybody else?
We talked about text messaging. It's another one of the largest forms of communication.
Our miscommunication.
And how people misinterpret often the messages because there's no body language, there's no facial expressions. So
right.
messages could be interpreted differently on
yes.
the end of the receiver than on the end of the sender.
Exactly. So the behavior would be?
Well, it could be positive or
negative.
Right.
So the
depending on the interpretation.
The medium is the text messaging. It was funny, I was working with a team and one of the women, she says, you know, I have my counterpart in Toronto, I keep calling her and sending her emails, I even tried text messaging, but she just never gets back to me. And I said, well, did you give her a deadline? And she's like, yeah, you know, I need it by the end of the day or whatever. And I'm like, well, have you ever spoke to her like on the phone or have you ever met her in person? No, never. And I said to her, do you have a relationship with her? She says, no.
First problem,
right? And that's not the first time I have that. It's like, oh, it's not really going well with that person. Well, do you have a relationship with them? No. So that's, I think, also part of it. So we've got to stand back and see, you know, why are certain things happening or not happening? Do I have a connection with that other person? Do they care to actually reciprocate the communication? Love it. Anybody else? Yes.
Well, we've also spoke about like maybe like the importance of the physical showing of that you're listening or understanding, but then we also spoke about not assuming about the way that somebody else is reacting as well. Like they might be reacting in a way which you think means one thing but doesn't necessarily like the cultural difference or even just relaying on something that's happened to them. So not jumping to assumptions about how somebody's acting towards you as
yeah.
what you presume to be their attitude towards you.
Exactly. Yeah. Does anybody have any examples of that?
Of the assuming?
Of either assuming or not assuming.
Assuming bad faith.
Uh-huh. And therefore?
Reacting based on that assumption.
Right.
Reacting based on a faulty assumption that somebody is acting in bad faith.
There
wrong.
We go. Yeah. And so that can only go in a bad
mm-hmm.
direction.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You have an example?
Oh, I was just going to add that, like, checking for understanding, especially when
yes.
we're communicating by email and text and stuff
yes.
before like reprimanding someone or like or if there's like an authority.
Yeah.
I know that happening many times. Like someone will write something to the authority figure and then they write back and they're like, well, why did you do that? And da, 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 da. But it's like that's not what was trying to be communicated,
right.
but that checking for understanding first could diffuse so many
absolutely.
Conflicts.
I love that, yeah. Checking for understanding. And that's that goes with not making assumptions. I think those go hand in hand. And I'll just share my quick little story. I was teaching one of my topics, which is instructional design, and I was teaching it to some teachers. And I had about 8 students in the class. And, you know, and they were really, you know, it's not an easy topic. It's a technical, you know, it's scientific. And so anyway, so they were getting it, and I had one student who had her face, you know, she was totally scrunchy, and she was going like this. Like, it looked like she was really not on board. Like, this was not happening for her. And so I tried to, like, block her from my view, because then I would take on her energy, and then I would second-guess myself, right? So then at the break, you know, I went up to her, and I didn't make any assumptions, giving my own advice. Didn't make any assumptions. I went up to her and I'm like, hi, how's it going so far? And she's like, it's great. It's like my face? I said, yeah, your face. And she says, oh, that's what I do when I'm learning, when I'm thinking, when I'm trying to figure things out. That's the face I make. And I'm like, ah, oh, she goes, I should have told you before. I'm like, yes. So that taught me really quickly that I can't make assumptions, you know, and I have to check in and double check. Great. So wonderful suggestions. What's really great about what I'm about to show you is a model. And so remember earlier on I asked you about deliberate, that word. Do you remember that word, deliberate?
Mm-hmm.
So that's a really important word. And I'm going to add another important word, which is consistent. So how can we be deliberate and consistent in our communication? And I have two models that I'm going to show you. And we're going to merge those models together as part of your action planning, which we're going to do at the very end. Okay? So there's actually a little bit of research done on positive communication. And it's Mirabel, so that's a wonderful little book called The Art of Positive Communication. It's actually written for first year communication students in undergrad. And I completely adore this book. So if this interests you, you can certainly pick it up. And he was the first person who coined the term positive communication. So as you can see from the year, is a very new area of communication. And so what I've done is I've taken it and I've dissected it a little bit to make it more digestible. Because as you can see from this definition, it's quite broad, quite large. And we're going to look at his model. We're going to be using his model in our activities.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Yes.
Please.
What's the name of the book?
Yeah.
The Art of Positive Communication. It's at the library at Concordia because I ordered it for the library.
And who is Mirabel? American, Canadian?
American. Michigan.
Democrat?
We could probably guess. But I don't know. Good? Everybody good now? Okay. So we're going to look at how I've dissected it in three ways. So at the foundation of positive communication, which is really an act, I believe that it really starts with positive thoughts. Oops, went the wrong way. Positive thoughts, right? So positive thoughts are internal, obviously, and they're unseen. But ultimately, it's the very most important part of this whole thing. Because if we can't have positive thoughts, it will be very hard for us to use positive words, and it will be very hard for us to have positive actions. So we're not going to spend a large amount of time in this workshop on this piece, but I just want to iterate that it is the foundation for the rest of it. And in my longer workshops and in my coaching, I do spend a lot of time around this because it is something that's in our heads constantly. And it's a practice and a skill to take that thought and flip it. We're going to flip words later, but not looking at thoughts just yet. So it is what we think, and through some of my research, these are some things that came out from people. I did my best in resolving the conflict this morning, so these are internal thoughts. You know, I did my best. It's not like, that was horrible, I'm terrible. No, I did my best in resolving the conflict. Or, I love myself, you know, you could say that over and over. Or, you know, my blank are beautiful and incredible. And so sometimes we focus on the 5 or 10%, right, that really just get us going. Because they're always there, it's a rule. But then we need to focus on the 95 or the 90 that are really beautiful and incredible. So we've got to say that in our head. So these are also things that I've said to myself. Then once we've got that, then we can look at using positive words, right? So one will affect the other. And it's what we say, and here are some of the things that came out. So thank you for having an open and honest conversation. These are things that we can say. Even if, you know, what was being said, as you mentioned, Catherine, even if what was being said was not maybe as optimistic or positive, we can still say thank you for having an open and honest conversation. Or hello, beautiful. Or how can I help you? As opposed to, you know, some other things that we say, some normal thoughts or words that come out as opposed to how can I help. Maybe some of you are thinking about them because I see some smiles. Then we layer on and this is what came out, and I heard some of you talking about that earlier. Smiling, eye contact, carrying acts, some of you talked about body language as well. So this is, you know, an easy model to sort of help us look at positive communication with three aspects. I'm going to now layer on Mirabelle's model. Forgot the little piece in the middle. Potential. So at the intersection of all this is, of course, our own personal potential to help have, you know, the one of the statements that I shared with you was, how can it transform our own world? So that's the potential for us. No matter what's going on around us, it's our potential to really have this positive outlook and then share it with others. So the art of positive communication. So this is, for me, was very revolutionary. This is part of his book. In fact, his book revolves around this model. And I will take you through it, and we'll do a few exercises around it. So the first thing he says, he calls these six behaviors. So you're gonna see as I take you through these, not rocket science, you know them all. You've probably done them all. But remember, coming back to how can we do this deliberately and consistently, and not, oh yeah, I did do that time, maybe, right? So we want this to be a practice as opposed to something we do by accident. So greet, so what is the greet? So here in his model, he says it's a greet is to create human contact. So how do you greet? And I just want you to think about it. I do have a self-assessment that you're gonna do. But you know, how do you greet to create human contact? Do you greet? And then based on who you are, you might not like those little small talk things, but the other person might really need that, right? So how do you greet? How do people react to your greeting? So just think about that. The next thing he says as a behavior is to ask. So we're asking questions. We're asking questions because we're curious, right? We want to learn about how the other person is doing. Ask to discover the unknown. So I might not know something. What are some questions I can ask to learn about the other person in a way that helps them to share? And, you know, it's very funny. This is really hard for people. I don't know what to ask. What am I going to ask? I don't know. So for each one of these behaviors, of course, there's lots more that we can do in terms of helping people create their own job aids for questions that they can ask. And I've helped some groups do that. Compliment is the next one. Some find it hard, don't like it. Some like it a lot, right? And all the way in between. So what he says is to affect a person's sense of self. But what are some other outcomes or benefits of complimenting?
Make people feel good.
Make people feel good? Yeah? What were you going to say?
Yeah, but that was the gist of it. So. But it's support also, and it's recognition.
Recognition.
And it shows them that you are paying attention.
There you go.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's what I was looking for. Yeah. So it shows the other person, wow, that person's paying attention. It could also have the completely opposite effect. You know, and I've been there. Like, don't compliment me. What do you want from me? You know, what are you trying to get out of me? And so that is a trigger to me that the person doesn't trust me. And that's important information. Because now I can work on it. Yes.
I was just thinking, if I'm meeting a peer versus meeting a car dealer, if you go to the car dealership,
right,
they immediately go through the greet, the ask, the compliment, and you can see they're just checking things,
yes,
off as they go around the circle. It's phony.
Yeah. So
it's
authenticity.
Yes.
Authenticity is really important. It starts with those thoughts that I was talking to you about.
Yeah.
And of course, we're focusing it on ourselves. So we can't control other people and what they do, but we can control how we do this. Yes.
And I think, like, the relevance of the compliment. You know, like, we hear this time and time again, especially when it comes to, like, you know, kids ask their parents, like, oh, mom, you look beautiful. Dad, nice haircut. Like, $20.
Yeah.
But when even with our peers, you know, when the compliment is something about,
correct,
you know, something very superficial.
Right.
Kind of like, okay, what do you want?
That's right.
If they're complimenting you on something you've done or
there
something
you
you've
go.
Shared.
Exactly.
That I find speaks
it's,
directly
it's
to
meaningful.
Like, yes.
Correct, yeah. So we want to be specific. And I'm just going to go back to my story from earlier, right? So if the teacher was specific in complimenting the 75 on on their behavior. She could have said something like, we noticed that you enjoyed the warm weather today. Or, Karen, it was nice to see you help Mario get on that swing. Or, how was that game of tag? It looked like fun. Right? How different is that energy that we're creating in the room when we're specific? Those were questions, so those would be an ask, but they could also be linked to compliment. All right, so those are three behaviors. Let's go through the next three. Disclose. Now we're getting serious. So Maribel says that disclosure is about deepening the relationship. Now this is where you're disclosing something of yours in your life that it doesn't have to be a deep disclosure, but a disclosure nonetheless. And so from my work so far, this seems to be the hardest one. What do I say about myself? I don't want to talk about myself. Oh no, I don't want people to know about me. That's my work life, right? So how can we do disclosure in a way that we're comfortable with? And then graduate over there. Anybody have any ideas about disclosure? What can you disclose? Yes.
Well, I think you need to pick up on what is of interest to the other person,
of course.
Or common ground.
Yes.
You know, so observing where they are also work. You know,
yes.
Do they have a picture of their kids? Do they have, you know, a picture of their dog? Whatever, you know, and then you're relating whatever you
that's
have
perfect.
That's in common.
Yeah.
Just to kind of get that comfort zone, to make it
right.
More personal,
yeah.
Then just merely a task.
Pooches always is awesome, right? You could disclose about your pooches because we love our little doggies, right? So that's a great idea.
Did you have your hand up?
Yeah. I think if you're gonna have like a really difficult or serious conversation, like sometimes exposing like a slight vulnerability
yes.
of our own like opens it can create a safe space.
Absolutely.
And like show that like maybe open up that other person.
Exactly.
Like,
and you know, we're not sure how other people are perceiving us.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I was actually this one woman in particular, she says, you know, I don't think people like me that much. And I said, what gives you that idea? She says, they don't look at me, you know, and they don't invite me to things, and I'm always alone. And I said, well, okay, let's talk about that a bit more. And it ended up being that people were intimidated by her. And because she's not a very gregarious person, right? And so she was more timid and to herself, but very lovely. And she had, when we worked on this together, she had this light bulb moment. And she says, yeah, maybe they're intimidated by me. So by disclosing a little bit more about herself and in her, you know, in her work maybe or in her private life, she could help build those relationships better. And so. Absolutely, yes. So we want to, again, not make assumptions and then go from there. Encourage. So this one's, I think, a little bit easier, self-explanatory. We want to give support. And then finally, listening. So listening is really important because it's hard to do. And it's something we have to work very hard at. But ultimately, you see, I love the little image for listening, is that actually we become... not one, but we connect, we overlap, which is really nice. So listen to transcend differences. So even though we might have different opinions, if I can listen to you deeply and appreciate what you're saying, I'm forming a very strong connection with you. And so at the center is what he says is if you can do these six behaviors deliberately and consistently, this is where influence happens, and inspiration for others. And if we go back to one of the statements I made earlier, positive communication enables positive behaviors, then that would be true, right? If I'm inspired by you, and if I'm influenced by you, then you will continue on with positive behaviors, or behaviors that will push you forward or lead you forward in your life, in whatever that case may be. Was there a hand up at the back? No. All right. Any questions about the model? Not rocket science, right? I'm sure you've all done these things. I just want you to think in your head before we do the activity, which one of these do you feel is easy for you? You do it deliberately and consistently, and you feel you're pretty good at it. So can everybody think of one? Not if you can. you don't do it enough, or maybe you don't do it authentically. Can you think of one? Just nod if you can. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to pick one or two. It doesn't matter if it's the easy one or the hard one. Remember, this is our playground, so of course you can try different things in this room. It's now a safe space. And so I want you to pick one or two. I want you to just connect with one other person in the room, because I think we're even again. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Woo! So get into groups of two and try one or two of them without disclosing which one or two you're doing. And then the other person can try to guess. All right, so I'm going to give you maybe 5 or 6 minutes, so you can have a 3-minute conversation each. Go ahead, get to know each other, choose two, and have a conversation. You probably want more time to continue talking. Were you successful? Did the other person guess the two that you had chosen? Yeah?
Sorry?
Did the other person guess the two that you were?
Oh, definitely.
Yeah. Okay. So, again, right? It's not difficult.
It was awkward when you both were listening. It was very awkward.
Well, we laugh and then we start talking.
There you go. So there's a bit of silence. Silence is actually a good thing. And we have to be careful. Yes, please. Any other comments about the practice activity? Yeah.
I'm an executive director for a nonprofit organization.
Uh-huh.
And if I didn't do everything that was in that circle, I wouldn't be doing my job.
There you go. Good.
Of course, there's some of those things that I'm better at than others.
Of course.
And Helena is also an executive director, and we work together all the time.
Uh-huh.
But it was cool because she picked out what she thought was my strength, which I thought was my weakness.
Look at that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Cool. Very, very cool. Yes.
We talked a bit about disclosure and trust.
Uh-huh.
Is that it's harder, well, each of us talking about it was difficult to disclose things to if we weren't sure what the person was going to do with the information.
Yes. Yep. So, if disclosure is one of the ones that you're going to put on your action plan, then you want to start with easy things, right? Things that are not deep and heavy. Because then that's scary. That does the opposite, right? Like, oh, I don't know about this person. Yeah, good. Yeah. Anybody else?
Just have an anecdote that I want to share about disclosure.
Yes.
4.5 years ago, I became academic dean, and one of the things we need to do is pedagogical days and organize them. And about the second pedagogical day, I let the team set up, you know, the PowerPoint with the Q&A, and it was like the game that was being played by faculty and members of the community. One of the last questions that popped up was, what's the name of my dog? And they had, you know, different things, and then the people were buzzing in the answers, you know. And there were like 3 people in the room who had no clue what the name of my dog was, but all the other 100 and so people all knew the name of my dog. So I said, okay, that's good.
Yes.
But it just shows how even people I hadn't spoken to about my dog knew about my dog.
Look at that.
Kind of thing, you know? So it's not like I'm going around every day talking about my dog, you know? But the thing is, the word gets out. And that taught me at that point, you know, it's like the information travels. You have no idea to who and how fast, but the information can travel. So then when you want to send a message out also to the community, that's one way of doing it. Disclosure is about not about yourself only, be about information you want to share.
That's right. That's true.
Like we're going to do X in the future.
That's right. Exactly. Yep. To open the transparency.
Yeah.
Love it. Yes.
I just want to know the name of it.
Whiskey. My dad like vodka, scotch, whiskey, and something else. And people were going like, okay, it must be one of these. But it was funny.
That was a very good ask. Awesome. So again, not difficult, but the key words are deliberate and consistent. So how can you bring this in a deliberate and consistent way to your communities? And I have a case study that I'll share with you a little bit later on. So right now you have two documents that I've handed out. The first one that I handed out is the cross-section of the two models. sort of the thoughts, the words, the actions are at the top. And then along the first column, you have all of the six behaviors. And so for the action planning, which we're going to do at the very end, is, and I'm going to give you a little bit of time now just because it's fresh and you've just done the activity if you want to jot anything down. So in your greets, you might have things you want to work on, and it could be at the thought level, the action level, or the word level. And so we can look at each one of these six behaviors in those three areas, the things we want to work on deliberately and consistently. Done, you can then turn to the other sheet, which is the self-assessment. So what you see are 20 statements that reflect the six behaviors plus influence and inspire. And you can rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 4. And then tally up your self-assessment, and then on the back side you've got some action steps. This is part of the action planning. So if there's anything that came out in the activity of something you want to work on, then you would just jot some notes in there.
Okay.
So it's the two models connected. So there's the behaviors on this side and the response action triggers. So if you say, okay, well, I do greet very well, but I have to work on my thoughts maybe before I do the greeting. Or I ask, you know, but it's, you know, maybe I don't ask very well and it's my thought process. So I gotta think about the questions first, as an example.
Okay.
What
so
action?
If we believe that to be true, we write that.
Correct. Yeah.
And
you don't have to fill it all in. It's just the
just
ones that came out for you.
Okay.
In the two that you practiced, or in the discussion.
The two we practiced were the ones we thought we were best at and worst.
Doesn't matter. Two that you.
One.
Two.
Yeah. Any two. Where did we?
Yeah, you can continue.
I feel like it's like, I don't want to make a big mess.
Well, you know what? I can email it to you.
Yes?
Okay. So if you want an email, just send me an email. And then I'll reply to the group if that's okay. Whoever's interested.
There must be an app.
Yeah.
Oh, they were supposed to put the PowerPoints, I think, on. Oh, that's not the PowerPoint.
No, it's not.
All right.
Are you requesting it? I am going to attempt to do that.
Do I get
your email address through the app?
I'm not sure. I thought
I'd be handling
it. You should.
Yeah. Okay. Or like really caring, like when you greet someone, being like,
I would say don't do it through the app because I have two phone
addresses.
Exactly. Because I've used it for other conferences and I use different email addresses. So if you can email me, that would be easy.
Sonia@harvestperformance.ca.
If you want a
handout, like in PDF form.
Oh, .ca.
She doesn't email herself.
I just
lie
down.
And you just gonna sleep. Just fine.
All right. Who needs more time for the self-assessment? Done? Almost? How did it go? Any thoughts? You don't have to share your results, but what are your thoughts around self-assessing yourself on each of the behaviors?
It was hard.
Yes.
Yeah, I said like being self-reflective on command can be difficult.
Uh-huh.
But I found myself like it was not that bad. But as I thought about different situations and like maybe different colleagues reacting to different people, like it would vary.
Of course.
Yeah. So
I felt like that too.
Yeah.
Especially with like the way I react in my family.
Yeah.
As opposed to the way I react.
So part of my bigger class, obviously, we look at different people, especially those you might have a hard time communicating with, and then based on that person, your strategy changes, right? Because it's not just based on what you like to do, but it should be based on what the other person would appreciate. So it changes based on the other. Yes.
So just a little funny anecdote.
Yes.
Every time I learn something in a workshop and we have a family gathering, incidentally, well, there's always a family gathering after that, I test things on my family.
Of course.
And most of the times they have no idea what I'm doing, but we've tried some of those, like, because we just have a habit of oversharing and constantly interrupting each other all the time. I'm like, wow, how can we get like the people, you know, there's the little kids running around, want to give them a chance to speak. And
because our family's like that too.
And so it's really fun to try it out. I suggest trying it out with your family or friends or just in a situation, especially when there's a few people. It's just to kind of go through it and try it out. That's what I'm going to be doing next weekend. We have a family gathering schedule.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's especially with those that may feel
you
know, less inclined to participate in in the festivities.
I find that it's the best way to test these things. And sometimes they think, you know, that you got abducted by an alien. Like my kids are like, oh, you're doing your thing, okay. but if it works on your family, because I think sometimes those are the hardest, sometimes they could be the
tough
hardest
problems.
Relationships, then they can really work on anyone. Great. Somebody else have their hand up? Would you be okay sharing your idea that you had? Because this is a self-assessment.
Yeah.
But there are issues with self-assessment.
Yeah, I was just telling Sonia that this would be something to do in a group, but you know, you come with a person you trust. So two people who trust each other. You do your own, and you do the one for the other person.
Mm-hmm.
And then they do the same thing for you, and then you switch. And then you compare their read of where you stand on this communication versus your own read of it.
Totally agree.
And with somebody you really trust, like you work together often, you communicate often, so you can do it, right?
Yeah.
And with the hope of obviously building on that. And that could really fine-tune your communication.
Of course.
That's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Because I just stuck a peek at playing his answers, and I'm like, no, you're not. I wouldn't have put that. Yeah, you're more critical.
Yeah. It could go either way.
Critical or improve, or say you're really good at this. You didn't know. You underscore yourself.
Exactly. And, you know, sometimes we think more highly of ourselves than is the reality. And both have happened, you know, both are true.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can gauge it with other people and have I think it's the conversation that ensues, which really is where the power comes in, and then you do your action planning.
Yeah. And having the structure, I think, is really
important. Well, that's what it is.
It's always difficult to tell, even to ask for feedback.
Of course.
You know, like you have a performance review, or you have something, and nobody wants to tell the other person, well, you know what?
People don't like
you. You know, or you talk too much. And sometimes, like, you'll ask yourself, you're like, oh, do I do this? And it puts the other person in an uncomfortable situation. But if you have this framework,
exactly.
then you're like, okay, let's all do this
structure.
As, you know, one-on-one or as a
takes
team.
The emotion out of it.
It does.
Yeah.
And you have language to refer
that's
back
right.
to. Not, you know what, that's really obnoxious.
That's a good point.
Stop that.
A good point about language. I'm going to make another point about
I noticed
when we started this process, that our staff has increased dramatically in the last few years, and I have a lot of younger people in my building. And I just want to go home next week and say positive communication is not called texting.
Yeah.
I have a really hard time getting my staff to communicate.
Mm.
Generational. I'd rather meet someone, have a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
Once I build a relationship, then texting and emailing will
there
follow.
You go.
But when you're building a relationship, it's not through. So I'll say, hey, can you contact blah, 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 at the SIS? Well, I sent them an email last week.
Yeah.
Well, did you call them? No, I'll re-email them tomorrow.
Yeah.
No. You will call them.
Yeah.
Community. But the generation of people in their 20s now,
yeah.
honestly, do not see the importance or understand the importance
I think that's what
of
it is.
Communication through
yeah.
oral, body language,
old-fashioned
communication. And I'm a real stickler for that, but do you have any pointers?
Yes, and I've got a hand up that she might have a pointer.
So, okay, so I'm not in my 20s, but I do, I can appreciate that I've worked in technology
mm-hmm.
in the schools for so long that it's all these preconceived notions and biases
mm-hmm.
that we have. I think in the end, it's about asking people how they want to be communicated with. That's not grammatically correct. I know
yeah.
the grammar's not correct there. But how do you want me to communicate with you?
Yeah, what
so in some
mm-hmm.
cases, because we deal with people multiple
mm-hmm.
ages, some people actually want the text messages. I'm not a fan of text messages. I'm not even a fan of email. I'm like, you need to meet me in person. I'm charming in person. My emails are no longer than two sentences. So, I try to do that for myself because I know my communication style.
Of course.
But not everybody is the same way. There are people that want to use Facebook. I do not like Facebook whatsoever, but I know that I need to
adapt.
Meet the people and adapt where they are.
Sure.
So I think you're right in saying that, like, if you know that the person on the other end at the CIS,
mm-hmm.
they're not going to answer email or they need to have that, then that's wonderful. And I think
they have to
just
towards.
Getting that conversation
yeah.
going is one of the biggest friction
yeah.
in terms of the different generations
mm-hmm.
in a workplace are the preconceived notions of people and how others like to communicate.
Mm-hmm.
Because if somebody sends me a text message, like just people twice my age would send me text messages, I'm like, please don't send me text messages, just call me if you want something. Or just walk over, or
right.
That's just,
yeah.
but that's my preference. And people would assume that because I'm, I'm in the younger range or closer to like the millennial, that's how I want to communicate. But no, I'm like you. Let's go for a coffee. Let's figure
yeah.
things out, and then if need be, we can send those like two separate emails.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's what I.
And I think that's
with.
A very important point.
Is.
I worked with a group of. They were in their 20s. They were sales, actually they were recruiters, but it was all for tech. And so everything was online and fast and quick and dirty and whatever. And so during our conversations, that came up as one of their big learnings was, I have to stop thinking about what I prefer, and I gotta start thinking about what the other prefers. But I think at the foundation, you got it in that if you assess the relationship, and you determine there is none, or there's no trust, then you have to work harder at the beginning, and the face-to-face, or at least on the phone, obviously, if distance is an issue, must be there in a deliberate way. Otherwise, I can send you a million text messages. If I don't know you, or if I don't feel a connection with you, I've got a million other things to do. And I'm gonna do those things because I don't have a connection with you. So I think that's really important.
I can remember 20 years ago when trade was opening up with China that people in North America expressed surprise that you couldn't do business in China unless you had a certain number of meals and times and developed a relationship with them.
Right.
But 20 years later, I think we see the importance and the wisdom of being able to establish that relationship.
Absolutely.
So that whenever you do disagree, there's a relationship that can sustain
there you
a disagreement.
Go.
Totally,
there you
totally
go.
Endorse that. Problem.
That's right. Yeah, and that's where conflict will happen.
Mm-hmm.
But if you trust each other, then.
then you know somebody's not staying up all night trying to make your life miserable because you have a relationship with them.
And related to communicating with young people, I've got an anecdote.
Yes, please.
I just have to share.
Go ahead.
My sister is a vice president of an advertising firm in Old Montreal in
okay.
the pharmaceutical industry. 50 employees, probably 2/3 francophone, 1/3 anglophone, half the Angles from here and half from Toronto.
Okay.
So sometimes they've got projects and she has to hold out the prospect of extra money if they work well. And she says if it's a baby boomer, you can say, we've got a big project coming up. And if you do well on this, there'll be a bonus for you at the end of the process. And they go away, knowing that there's a prospect of a reward if they work hard. She says with the Gen Xers, who are late 30s, early 40s, they have to know what the reward is. And with the millennials, they want the reward.
Wow.
So.
Did she publish?
It's not rewards.
So.
So.
You pay for what you're for.
It just shows how, whether it's trade with China or interactions within your own community, everything's always changing. The norms are.
So let me ask you a question. How did she figure out her formula?
As a result of her experience over 5-10 years with the staff, she distilled it into that entertaining anecdote.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Which may be oversimplified to some extent
and
a bit sensationalized. But as a former journalist, I like oversimplified sensational stories because people remember them.
Yeah. Exactly.
And there's always a degree of truth to them.
Of course. And I mean, it goes back to the whole idea of flexing towards the other person, right? Maybe they want it in a different way.
Yeah.
And somebody wanted to say something.
I just wanted to add, with the youth right now, is that they're also, they have a great fear of the face-to-face. They have a great fear of being in personal space and talking to people. They're not comfortable with it at all. So you know, texting for her, for them, with emoticons and everything is the way they want to do it. When they get to the point of even a phone, they don't like to be on the phone. It's a live voice. You know, you need to deal with the situation right now.
Yeah.
So there's all this kind of understanding that they haven't had a lot of experience.
That's right.
Of even how to meet and greet, like we were talking and all that. For us, a lot of those things, we know those things, I'd be interested to see in 5 years when you're talking to people who are coming to 20 years of age, they're 15 now, and they don't know how to relate to people next to them.
And in fairness to young people, I've thought of what the deeper meaning of that story is. And the charitable explanation would be that young people don't trust the system is going to work for them.
That's true, actually.
Yeah. Well, who created it? Who created the system that they're living in? I feel like I'm always like trying to help the underdog, right? Because here's another story. I was part of this this group, and it was an intergenerational consultation. It was from the business bureau. I forget what those things are called. And so they invited baby boomers, Gen X, and Gen Y. The youth, right?
Millennials.
It wasn't called millennials yet. That term didn't exist. So it was, the youth coming in. This was like maybe 15 years ago. And they wanted to know, everyone had something negative to say about the younger generation. The baby boomers had something to say about the Gen Xers and the Gen Ys. The Gen Xers had something to say about Gen Y. And then those who are kind of in between, and as the new people are coming in, everyone has something to say about the other generation. It is, I agree with you, it makes a catchy phrase, you want to click on that and read more about it. But in the end, we're bypassing what we're trying to do, which is we're using our own biases to say, well, you're like that, and that's just how it is, and you're all like that. And I just have like a fundamental problem with that, and I think that we need to break that cycle. Because if this is the way the youth are, well, the youth are the children of the people at this conference.
Right.
Right? And the following youth are gonna be the children of the people, of the youth of the people from this conference.
So it's gonna get worse.
We create it, and things come in cycles,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes.
Everybody does the opposite of what their parents did, and then they do the opposite of what their parents
we're
did.
We're trying
we
to correct
the circle.
It, and we're causing additional problems.
They're gonna run a reward with no work.
It's a transition. Stay home and we'll pay you.
I just feel bad that all of these people are getting, you know, all of this
bad
reputation. And you know what? There, it's a difference in work ethic, of course. It's a difference in communication. You know, for whatever reason, I'm not saying they're perfect and nobody is perfect, but one of the things that I came away with was, so this man was saying, I wanted to hire somebody, this young Gen Y person or millennial in this case. And they came in and, they didn't even come in. I called him and I said, can you come in for an interview on Friday? And he said, well, I can't come on Friday. I'm sorry, I'm going on a ski trip. Can I come in on Tuesday? And the guy's like, well, of course, I didn't hire him because he doesn't show work ethic. I said, really? Because he actually showed that he made a commitment. He's going to stay. You know, he's going to honor that commitment and offered an alternative. It's not what he wanted to hear. I'm not saying the young guy was right either. No right or wrong. I can't make that judgment. But we're focusing on different things. There's a positive and negative.
Of course. Yeah. And I think fundamentally what you're saying here, and it's like really at the core of my mission, if I can call it that, is really that it doesn't matter, like we can erase all those generations. Like I used to have a piece on generation and I threw it out because we're all individually unique. Like if we could just focus on the fact that everybody's different, then it doesn't matter. We don't have to categorize people. And so if I can learn to listen and do all these things, it's not up there anymore, but you know what I'm talking about when I do that. If you can do all those things, it doesn't matter, really, right? And then so the connection is the most important part. And the piece in the middle, which we didn't spend a lot of time on, but really is very important, is the inspiration and the influence. Right, and so that's ultimately is connection with another human being with these communication behaviors that maybe we're doing less of as a generation, and I call us all in the same generation. You know, makes it harder to connect and then therefore influence and inspire. And so some people do it really well. And you know, at a class the other day, and I asked, you know, think of somebody who's inspired you, and it's not hard to come up with it. And when you dissect what they do, trust came up, but a lot of those behaviors are there, right? So so good, excellent conversation, good self-assessment. If you do want the handouts in PDF form, please email me. So I'm gonna sort of focus now on the word part. So remember we looked at thoughts, words, and actions. So we're going to focus now on the words, and so I have a little activity for you. It's called flip the phrase. So again, you can work in twos or threes, and these are low energy phrases. They used to be called negative phrases, but I didn't feel they were very negative, so I rebranded them. So they're low energy phrases, and I need you to flip the phrase into high energy phrases. So this is going to be a fun, quick activity. You don't have to do them all, so you can pick and choose maybe five or six, and then we'll see how you do it, and I'll show you the right answers. All right? So let's do 5 minutes. 5 minutes. Smaller groups.
Okay.
Is that
I know.
I got a question.
By high energy phrase, you mean you turn it into a more positive
Correct.
Way of saying.
Correct.
That's great.
So why not is negative, right? Even though I'm implying something positive, it is a negative. It's a low energy. So how can you convert it to be high energy?
Yes.
Of course. Yes, of course.
Yes, of course. Yes, we can do it.
We can do it for sure. Well, the problem is low energy.
That's what
saying?
I
No, I'm reading.
Oh!
okay.
No problem.
Totally enthusiastic.
But if you're really not, try not to be enthusiastic.
Okay, if anybody is doing that, don't.
Exactly.
I forgot a couple of
Most
words.
Definitely.
It should be don't do that, dot, 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 or don't, you know, don't.
Because it depends on the
action. Yeah, how do you like that?
I'm going to say I'm exhausted in a positive way, though.
I'm so busy.
That's worse.
Don't complain.
I'm just so busy. What are you doing?
Yeah, how are you?
Yeah, but
oh
it's still super
busy.
I'm exhausted at least.
Which ones have you done?
One.
So busy, it's making spaces.
How are you?
I'm
exhausted. Like, you have to be disclosing.
I've not listened so much.
What?
I can't hear you.
Oh, sorry. I'm just
and I can't see you actually.
Oh my
I see your mouth moving.
Yeah.
So one more minute.
That's really
yeah.
See how many more you can do.
Yeah.
Don't action.
Okay. Let's get a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
There we go.
Let's go for a walk.
Let's go for coffee.
Yeah.
Let's go for tea. How about some tea?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
To give us energy.
So,
yeah.
To give me energy.
Yes, that's
very good.
It's
well, it's not for everybody. Yeah, because some people's like, well, that's a positive thing. I missed you.
I think I'll forget it. I'll let it down.
Yeah.
I'll
tell
you
this.
Do.
All right, who wants to see the answers?
Oh, my.
Everyone.
You ready?
Removing everything before but, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah, for the ones at the bottom. Yeah, so the ones that these ones here are. Can you try to identify the what connects those three? Why are we removing the first part of those?
You're editorializing it.
Yeah, you're qualifying.
Yeah,
like
it's almost passive aggressive.
So you're you're minimizing.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
It's like I don't want to bother you, but or you probably know this. And so we're minimizing our presence and our power.
Mm-hmm.
So we just have to cut those things out. Okay. How about your own? Do you have any phrases that you want to try to flip?
You mean besides the ones that are
besides
on
these
list?
That are on here? Yes.
I caught myself saying no a lot, but not in the sense of no as in negative, more as no but. I don't know if it was being around kids for so long. You know how they their initial answer is no, bizarre habits,
right,
and things like
yes.
that we find cute or that we will say like we'll criticize and then we find ourselves doing it. Yeah, no, just me. I'm like a sponge when it comes to kids. So saying no but or trying to explain something.
Oh, okay.
Right? So
when you have something to add or something?
Or somebody asks a question. See, I almost did it now. No, but.
Yeah, the no.
So what could we say instead of no but?
Well, yes and.
Yes and.
Or just not saying it at all.
Yeah. Well, yes and is a thing.
Yeah.
Right? So there is an activity called yes and, if you haven't heard of it. Very cool. And it's very important, especially for those who speak for a living, if you're a teacher. And we can do that with the children as well. Anybody else? You had something, I think. Or did you want to?
No, I'm good.
You're good. So there could be other things, right? So you can create your own list of things you want to start changing. In fact, I had a few students tell me that they just chose one thing that they would stop doing. And one of them, for her, it was people would ask her, you know, as everybody does, how are you? And she would say, not bad. And so that was her project for the week. They had to do one thing every week, and that was her project to stop saying, not bad. And instead, she would say, I'm fine, or if she felt very excited that day, I'm great, or whatever, but anything but not bad. And she did that for 1 week, and she said she couldn't believe the results, in that people were responding to her better. It would ensue further conversation. And in fact, you know, apart from the fact that people were responding to her, she felt better. She was in a job she didn't like, but by doing that small change at the start of her day, it changed her mindset, which we said at the beginning is at the foundation of everything else. And so there was another gentleman, and he wasn't getting promoted, he wasn't getting special projects, and so he also started adopting some of this high energy phrasing. And within a week, I mean, in very short periods of time, within 1 week, people were coming asking for his opinion. He was being consulted with, and he just couldn't believe it. He thought, it's like a simple little thing, and all of a sudden, I'm on top of the world. And he was being invited onto special projects. It was, I almost didn't believe him, but he was for real. Yes.
I've thought of this a few times
yes.
in this session. Like, I think of people who tend to be introverted or
yeah.
extroverted, and a lot of this seems like it would lean towards more extroverted people who are like, yeah, like, let's get together, like, let's meet face to face, I'm great, let's have a direct conversation. And like, I'm okay with that because generally I'm that kind of person,
yeah.
but I will have colleagues that,
yeah.
like, even like some of the things in the self-assessment, they're just going to be harder for somebody who
yeah.
tends to be introverted.
Yeah.
Well, if you
yeah.
have social anxiety, it's one of the things I was thinking
oh.
about as well.
Well, of course, yeah. I mean, any of these things, I mean, if there are other clinical issues, then of course, this isn't going to solve it. Might make it worse, actually. But, you know, my energy, like, I'm more of an extroverted person, so I will exude, you know, what you've just said. But essentially, what I help people do is use it for them. You know, they're going to use the model in their way that's comfortable for them. So it is, like, there was one woman, she's like, I hate the greet, you know. By the end of it, she came up with some things that were comfortable for her, and she started integrating. So it really, it has to be something that you build that's comfortable for you. Yes.
So, I mean, I asked that question before, so I'm like, well, if I do all of these things, and there's some of the things that I'll do to excess. Like, clearly, I'm an extroverted thinker, and I like to chat with people.
Yeah.
Like, I dive into conversations.
Really?
I might not know you right now, but we will know each other by the end of the session. And so we're also talking about the introverts, extroverts. And so for
yeah.
me, when I was going through the exercise, I'm like, oh, maybe I need to tone down a bit of this.
Uh-huh.
Or like find myself pausing.
That's right.
I work with a lot of introverts.
Yes.
I'm like, at some point, I'm like, I don't know that I've heard them talk. Like, they're really good at doing the ask.
Yeah.
They're good at listening.
Yeah.
You know, so they might want to work on some part, and then I might want to work on the ask and the list.
So can you share with them what I mentioned to you then?
That's what I internalized from what you were sharing with me.
Yeah, so in your action plan, like if
yeah.
there are some that you feel you overuse,
yeah.
share some case studies and then our final action planning. So what are the benefits now that I've taken you through the models, we've done some activities, we focused on words, but of course thoughts and actions are very important too. Think about your communities and your community, the well-being of your community, in applying some part of any of this, what would be the benefits to you? And I'm just going to take a note of these things. And this is just popcorn, so you can just share whatever comes to mind.
If you're taking a moment to pause and have positive thoughts, you know, you may need to go in, you know, talk to the person, bring something up that's going to require a lot of work or commitment or anything. But the thing, I think, it sets your mindset from the get-go, and you realize how you need to broadcast that, be it through your body language, your written, your whatever. And so I have to sometimes remind myself that I'm the dean, because I don't see myself as the dean, in the sense that I'm very lateral in my management style. And so I've had in some conversations, sometimes I'll, you know, encourage people to kind of rise to the various occasions. And I had one of my very good, you know, employees basically say, "Sorry, Roy, that's a career-ending move for me." And it like hit me like a brick, because I didn't realize what I was asking them to consider.
Right.
And I said, okay, that's true. It's like, I kind of forgot about that. Thank you for putting me back in my spot. And it's really important. So I think the daily mindset, I think, is really good. And you understand where you need to, your role is, you reassess. Because if you're going to break down the hierarchy, then there's other challenges.
Mm-hmm. And so if you did these two things, what would be the outcome?
Well, the outcome is how people receive your information. That's the first thing,
right.
I would say. And that you're looking also, I would say that as you're setting up your mindset, you're also deciding who you want to work with you. There's exactly the better reception, you know, who's really going to be more engaged. And the likelihood is you're going to go see them. You need to broaden that, because you can't always count on the same people.
There you go. Good.
So you need to kind of challenge the ones who are just on the periphery, and then that circle of people you got is going to enlarge, but it takes time.
So better receptivity of message, but I'm also hearing better implementation in the long run.
Yeah, and I would say, you know, more buy-in. We're going to use that term, but it's in the sense people have a common vision.
Yeah.
You, if you're listening to them and they listen to you, and then it's back and forth and sharing with more people.
Yeah.
You probably have more people in consensus.
Got it. Yes.
I would say more sustainable or resilient relationships.
Oh,
like I said.
Sustainable, resilient relationships, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else?
You could throw authentic in there. There's a bunch of adjectives.
Yeah.
I think that if you're a more positive communicator, then you're also more of an empathetic listener. That will help you be more in tune with the needs of your community, which will help you develop policies and programs, whatever, to the benefit of the community.
I think also the idea of giving a language or a framework to something that you can refer to and maybe is universally understood by different people,
yes.
And maybe putting it into this language that people don't necessarily relate to or understand, maybe putting it into other people's language in a kind of more structured,
mm-hmm.
universal way is
mm-hmm.
productive.
Increased productivity, I think, yeah. Okay.
I would say it's not
activities, I think it's an increased commitment that you get from people.
Yeah.
I don't think it's productivity. You're probably gonna get the same product in the end, whatever you're asking.
Yeah, not an outcome,
but
yeah, constructive.
Exactly. It's constructive, it's like, and I think more commitment in the sense that even if they might identify things that are working or not working for them, and they can really help you in your role, you know? So people have, everybody plays a different role, but they can help each other out.
Of course.
I would disagree that you get the same product, though. Like, I imagine that there would almost certainly be a higher quality of what you're getting.
Yeah.
So higher quality outcomes?
Yeah. Like, if you're working together on a project and your team is, has a good relationship, so I think people bring that much more energy, and there's that much more collaboration and energy sharing within the group.
Yep. Anybody else?
I heard somebody about to say something.
No? So, I don't know how to phrase this, but you might even get better ideas, right? Because when you've built these good relationships and you have this trust in the team, people feel safe to share their wacky wild ideas that might actually be constructed into something, you know, a product or a service that will be of benefit, right?
Of course.
And that's within the organization, but also with the people that you serve, your end user, if you will.
Okay. Yep.
Yeah. I would add that there would probably be more ideas. As people like you and I shut up for a little bit, and we let the introverts talk.
Yes.
Like, they're so, I have so many colleagues and partners that are
just
like, there's so many good ideas that come out if we just stop talking for a few minutes.
Yeah.
I feel like I can say that to you.
Yeah. Kindred spirits right here.
Is that
all right? It's real tough.
Good. So good benefits. We're bonding, I think, is what's going on. I'd like to transition now into some case studies. So I'm going to share with you a case study that I worked on where we used positive communication in the project without actually teaching positive communication. So positive communication was just embedded into the framework. And then we're going to go, then I'm going to share a second where we go from here as practitioners. I'm hoping all of you will now be practitioners in a deliberate and consistent way, and then in the research as well, and then we're going to end with final action planning. So I worked with a school. It was a junior elementary school in Montreal, in the Lester B. Pearson School Board. And the case study, it's a case study because I went in, they wanted to do a PD activity. So it was like, you know, come in for a few hours, do something. And then I went in and I spoke with the principal, and as she explained to me what was going on, I said to her, I can certainly come in and do a 2-hour whatever, but I'm not sure that's gonna solve your problem that you've just described to me. So let's look at, and so what we called it was School Community Alignment and Growth Project, and it was a focus specifically on the teachers and the staff to cultivate a positive school community. So the situation was that the principal was new in the role, a couple of years, and the teachers and the staff had been together for 10 to 25 years. And so what had happened is there was also like a two camp on the teacher side in terms of how they saw how education was to happen in the classrooms. And so now we were joining two schools. And so the teachers asked for help, and what we did instead of a PD is we actually did a full 1-year intervention so that we met on a periodic basis, and I'll share what that looked like. I've left the results blank because I'm gonna come back to that. So the program was an initial workshop, which was probably about 3.5 hours with everyone at the beginning of the school year, before the school year started. And then we did monthly group development work, which were just little activities to help them connect because there were no relationships. Like, some had relationships, but some didn't. And the level of trust was really terrible. So we worked month by month, and we kept coming back to the program objectives. So there was continuity. And that was one of the outcomes that people said, was that you know, we keep coming back to the pillar. And so it was really easy these PD days, even though they didn't want to come to them because they had other things they would rather do. By the end of it, they would be like, that was really good, that was very necessary. And so those were the different dates we met. And then I produced a final report. So we did collect some data, which I'm going to share some of that today. So the learning model was really, it was dynamic in that we didn't go in planned what we were going to do. It would be based on what was going on. We would go in and generate discussions. So we would plan, determine the goals based on the need. There would be a do phase where they would implement their action plan and see the results in their everyday. And then we would come back together and review what went well, what they needed to improve on, and any questions they might have. So what we did is we started with a co-creation team activity, which I do with my students. So Anna's not here, but I have done it with Anna many times in classes, where they co-create what I call team guiding principles. So they built these. This was their list of guiding principles, and every action, thought, or word would be focused or filtered through this list. And just the act of co-creating this without somebody saying, this is what you need to do to each other, they co-created it, which means these are the things that were important to them. And so the fact that it was on paper allowed them to have permission now to have the conversations around some of these things. And then what we did is we built the action plan around these ideas. And these team principles was now, they had them printed, they had them as part of their staff discussions or teacher discussions or interactions with each other. So this was something that became part of their culture. Then we brainstormed three topics. What is the biggest goal you can shoot for this year? So this was all in the kickoff. And again, they co-created this list. Nobody came up with it for them. They did it themselves. And then, of course, everything that ensued was revolved around these biggest goals. And then we came back around at the end to check whether the goals were met. And again, this was coming from two camps of teachers, right? And then so that it was very tense that they came up with this. This is what they wanted. We talked about what does it mean to lead, teach at a high level, because there was differences in opinions there. So again, they co-created their list together. They agreed on these five things. Now respect came up number one. Respect can mean a lot of things to different people. So that's one of the things we worked on in our monthly session. And finally, they're doing lots of things right. So taking appreciative inquiry as part of it, what are you doing that makes a big difference? And so that was really nice for them to share their best practices, and they came up with their top five. So again, that was the situation. What we did is we collected various data over the year at three points. We collected it following the first kickoff. Then again after the holidays in February, and then again at the end of the year. And so what we collected were their action items. What did they say they were going to work on? And then they self-assessed their various different So what increased is interesting. I'm going to share with you the top four. Here is the top three. So these are the three that increased the most. So I can now self-assess my communication skills, increased by 1.55 points. So it wasn't something they ever thought about before. Now we worked on that quite a bit, so there was an increase in self-awareness. Identify communication breakdown. So a lot of times they would be like, oh no, everything's fine. But now they were able to see through body language, oh, you know, maybe that person didn't appreciate what I just said. So that increased. And then ability to resolve communication breakdowns, which I think is huge. Because just identifying them is not enough, but it actually came in as very high, the ability to resolve communication breakdown. And then we also collected their confidence in their self-reporting. So I wanted self-assessment to be as strong as possible. And so what we did is I asked them, how confident are you in your self-assessment? And and then we reduced the pointage based on their self-assessment. So if they were only confident that that number was a 50%, we decreased it by 50%. So these are the figures, August, March, and May. Oops. My marking is done. So these were some of the skills that we were working on. So I self-assessed my communication skills, went from a 6.4 to an 8. These have already been decreased by the confidence levels. So their increase was 1.55. Identify communication breakdowns, 1.3. And then I resolve communication breakdowns, 1.322. And then the fourth one, which is interesting, is I observe the impact of my communication style, which is also really important from a self-assessment perspective, because there was a lot of headbutting and walking away. Whereas now they understood that they needed to work on that, and they could observe that in each other. So the outcome was really good. Here's some qualitative feedback from what was shared. And it came up here in terms of language. I don't know if I included that one, but that was a big key theme, was that we have a common language now that we talk about as we're passing the halls or we're in our own meetings. We're using the same language. So the guiding principles, as well as some of the theories or concepts that we were talking about, like flexing. We talked about flexing earlier. It's like, oh, you're flexing, cool. So they would commend themselves in the hallways or in their own classes. The other thing I wanted to mention here is at least two people, it saved their marriage. One woman saved her marriage, and the other one increased her relationship with her daughter. So it transcends past the workplace into the community, which is really important. And it's not the first time I've seen this happening, in that people say to me, you know what, I now have a relationship with so-and-so from my home life, and I didn't have one before. So in increasing self, we can increase the connection we have with others. So of course, more research is needed. As I mentioned here in the action plan, Mirabel suggests more research, of course, and he suggests increasing the research on the different behaviors, so to dive into each of those behaviors and do research in each of those. I'm proposing a research, which I haven't kicked off yet, but it's brewing. And I am looking for a potential environment to host this research. So if any of you know of anybody or are interested, please let me know. So I've called it Positive Communication Encourages Positive Behaviors and Well-Being Using a 3-Year Systematic Approach Across a School Community. What I've learned in my first research project was I only worked with teachers and staff. And what I heard from those teachers after a year is, we're still using the language, we're still doing these things. So that was really nice that it lived past their 1 year together. However, we didn't look at the school board. We didn't work with the parents, and we didn't work with the students. So the proposal here is to look at the whole community and bring this into a phased approach over time. So the students would be in year 3. They would learn about it in year 3, but really they've had it for the whole time because the adults around them are also exhibiting these behaviors. So I want to be able to research the impact of that over a school, a three-year. So it doesn't have to be a school, but this was sort of the proposal that I put out. Any questions? So again, remember those four questions I showed you at the beginning that was true and false? We don't know. There's not enough research out there. It sounds like it's common sense. You know, you listed some really great benefits, but we don't know for sure. So that's what inspires me to try to put it into the hardest population, which is public, diverse school system, which with the little ones, right? Because we talked about, we're just making this worse from year to year to year, or the next 5 years, who knows where we'll be. So if we can start with them at a young age and then help impact the adults with their own well-being, we had such great results with such a small community. community at one level, I could just imagine the benefits over large. This is being done very well at the private sector, not really well documented in the public sector. So in order to carry a positive action, which is what we want to do as a result of these past 2 hours, we must develop a positive vision. So this is the community legacy that I developed based on the focus for this forum, for the, you know, the 3 days of the forum. And when I read these and I pulled these out of the materials, I thought this is very much aligned with some of the concepts that I shared with you today and some of my own research focus. So it's really important that we start with the legacy. And I'm not gonna take you through the model. I did a presentation yesterday on this model. Some of you were there. But what I'd like for you to think about is, in this model, we want to really, we know that there's going to be some emotional blockage. You know, as you start approaching this model, maybe presenting this model, or helping your community thrive by using these approaches, there's going to be an emotional block at some point. We have to address it, realize it, become aware of it, and then push through into maturity. And this is where the learning journey happens. The awareness, the observation, connecting with others. The more we learn, the more uncertain we are, the more confident we are. Of course, as part of the model, we're gonna get stuck again as we come around into the emotion, because it's gonna fail. Something's gonna go wrong. And I use, you know, a new job as a potential example. Starting a new job, yay, so great. And then as we grow, there's going to be something that's going to happen. It's a predictive model. And then, oh, let's be aware of it. Don't beat ourselves up about it. Become aware of it, push through it, so we can mature into our role and learn. And then as we come back, of course, something's going to go wrong again. Become aware of that emotion and then come around. And so as we come around, we can achieve our legacy and create something new. And so the important thing is to celebrate the wins that you will have, hopefully, if you implement some of these things. And so as part of our action planning next steps, I'd like for you to think about your legacy vision, your positive vision. And so if we start here, we could reverse engineer it to plan for the learning journey and the emotions that can help us get stuck. And we can help others through it as well. Yesterday I had a couple of conversations about people that want to implement this in their volunteer association. So how can we help them plan for their legacy as part of their volunteer work to not sort of lose focus? It's being implemented at a university for students coming in, so when they start, they build their legacy and then they stay focused and it gets revised and shared over the length of their studies. So this can be used in various many different ways, but for you right now, I'd like for you to focus on what is your community legacy that you want to leave behind for your people in the community well-being. So I'm going to give you a few minutes to think through what is the end result, what is going to happen as a result of possibly using some of these concepts. And then I'll just ask a few people to share. So a few minutes, think through. I know it's a deep conversation at the end of the day, but you can just jot down some notes or ideas. Again, this is about the return on investment of the past 2 hours that we've been together.
So it's like, what do I want my legacy of positive communication to be?
Yeah, and it could be for you personally, or it could be for your community.
Right, cool.
Whatever community you're part of.
Yeah.
We did three of our classes, did you do them out of your class?
Multiple.
Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah, there's not one, there's not one.
They were useful, especially useful with
thinking like in
project management.
Yes.
Because we're like, okay, it's a great group, but we're very different.
It's your role.
I've never
Established
But you
provincial
think
how
you
work and stuff.
Yeah.
And
you guys were so, I had to pick
it was,
one,
I love
right?
Like,
it was
so
really
like,
good.
What we do is
yeah.
Yeah.
Coaching
yeah.
And
professional
yeah.
Development.
And I, the ones I tried
so
not doing it,
leadership.
I had to start
at
class.
Skills
yeah.
Like at the school level, so it's principals. Sometimes it works with teachers as well.
So I don't think
you
have
negatives right after
you
go working. It's a good thing to do before you do group work as well sometimes. Before you go into groups.
That's
if you do it after you already formed the group you're gonna be working with for the rest of the semester and you're like, oh.
So that's
like
yeah,
this is going to work, but it's too late. So it's cool
to
do
overcase
competition.
I didn't
yeah.
Use it multi
level
because we didn't have the time we're looking at. And then I invested
So we developed the provincial partnerships, but then we're also coaching people on the ground.
So it's a must.
And then we're also trying to promote on the provincial training. There's so much of that.
All right. So I love it. People are still writing. People are talking. Love it, love it, love it. Does anybody want to share some ideas that you have for legacy?
Mine are all pretty personal, I think.
You don't have to share.
No, it's just, I don't mind sharing more.
Yeah, sure.
That others trust me and that I trust myself.
Excellent. So people would say, I trust Angelina.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Good. Excellent. Love it. Anybody else?
I hear good things about you.
That helps.
Here we talked about how the legacy could be for your organization,
yes.
For your sector,
yes.
For your broader
of course.
Community, and they might be the same or they might be different.
Different, yep. And co-creating that legacy as well could be something very powerful in that I use that with highly conflict teams, co-creating their legacy was just wonderful. Anybody else? One more? For those of you that were writing or thinking? No? All right. So I'll bring it to close. I'm going to just, I don't know how to skip through slides on the PC, but close your eyes. All right, there we go. So workshop objectives, I'm just going to come back to the objectives to see if they've been met and how, and if they haven't for you or not to the degree that you would have liked, please do connect with me. You've got my contact information on your handouts, but also I've given you my email address. So describe positive communication principles or behaviors. Do you feel capable of doing that now? Using a framework, yes? Self-assess your communication style, thoughts, words, and actions. Lots of nods in the front. List your personal benefits for using positive communication on a daily basis. So we did that as a large group. Use positive communication to improve your relationships. That's part of the action plan. And plan to use a communication framework to cultivate positive action and transform your world. So, hopefully, and
to be determined.
It's small, but you've got an action plan, and hopefully you've written some things in there that you can help yourself, but ultimately, right, this session was about community. So how can now you bring this forward into your communities to see some of this stuff happen in real life? So when we started, I think, it was, can't see your name right now,
Catherine.
You talked about it's how people make you feel. So this is a quote that I love, and I think it's very much aligned to this positive communication stuff. We can't touch it really, but that's not really that important as to how we make ourselves feel when we use some of these principles and how we make others feel. So I do have a challenge if you want to take part in it. It's called Practice Positive Communication Language. You can sign up on my website.
I have been told that it's quite challenging, and so they're like, you made it too challenging. I'm like, what's a challenge? So it does revolve around some of the concepts we saw today. So you're already a leg up for those that didn't hear me speak about it. And you can certainly share it with others so that they can do it too. And it increases their capacity and knowledge around positive communication. I hope that was helpful for you today. Interesting. I loved hearing all of your comments and suggestions and your conversation. Thank you very much. Any final comments?
That may just try the challenge.
Yes. Is it set up for like a team?
Now,
well, you could, I mean, it is individual.
Is there a reward for me at the end of it?
I'll take it now, thank you.
The reward is the increase in knowledge. But it is meant to be, the challenging part of it is that you have to share and talk to people during the challenge. So you could do it as a group. And the other thing I was told is that you can't do it in a row. Like, it's not something you can do 9 days in a row. So you would do day one. And even though you get day two, on day two, don't make it panic. Like, one was like, I was so panicked, I had to do them all, and then I didn't do any of it. But I said, no. Do the one, you know, it might take you a week to do day one. That's okay. And then you can do another week or a few days later, and then you can progress that way.
Communication, like I said, in my office is difficult.
Yes.
Don't tell anyone outside this room. For me as an executive director, because I'm extremely, anyone that knows me, I'm blunt. So I don't always sugarcoat things.
Right.
So I struggle with that.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to hopefully taking this 9-day challenge.
Perfect. Awesome. Yes, and please, you know, reconnect with me because I try to improve things, you know, for mass consumption. Sometimes in my head it looks and feels great. But so any feedback that you can provide as you use any of the tools, right? I'm gonna email you some tools. Please do keep in touch and let me know about things. Yes?
Is the content of your workshop on your website? Because that's most of it.
It is not exactly.
No.
But I can send you, or we can have a conversation about it. So all the websites are there, and you can access my email through the website.
I don't understand why people just don't know about the
shop. Thank you. Sure.
I find it really tough.
I just need to take this call.
Oh, yeah. Time's up. Like, you can go.
All right.
In a partner.
328.
Relationship, I'll send talk.
You did the parking, yeah. It went off.
Because I know that care.